start introducing myself. So Stephen Meeneghan, I'll answer to anything. I am a naturopathic doctor and an acupuncturist. I'm the first ND to be part of Cedars-Sinai. I'm now the clinical director of that program. As it says here, we're going to be talking about integrating complementary therapies with your conventional care, those and your loved ones. So for those of you who don't know what a naturopathic doctor is, let's see, let me jump to, I don't think I have that slide. So naturopathic doctors are trained as integrative primary care providers. And in every state there's, so we're licensed in about 20 states now. So for those of you at home, you may or may not have licensed naturopathic doctors within your state, but there definitely are naturopathic doctors in your state that may be practicing as consultants rather than as physicians. But in California, we have a decent scope of practice. There are not very many of us that are actually integrated into health systems, so I'm one of the lucky few in that regard. And as it says there, I'm also an acupuncturist. The Cedars-Sinai Medical Group launched the Integrative Health Program about 3 years ago, and it's slowly growing. So let's talk about what integrative medicine is to start with. I'll insult your intelligence and just read this to you here. This definition comes from the Academic Consortium for Integrative Health and Wellness, which is a group of 70 health systems in the United States, including obviously Cedars-Sinai, but UCLA, Stanford, Duke, Harvard, et cetera. So this is the definition that they've collaborated on. Integrative medicine and health reaffirms the importance of the relationship between practitioner and patient, focuses on the whole person, is informed by evidence, as he mentioned earlier, and makes use of all appropriate therapeutic and lifestyle approaches, healthcare professionals, and disciplines to achieve optimal health and healing. So that's a kind of definition that most of us can get behind, that most of these health systems can get behind, that there's a value in as long as it's informed by evidence that there is a potential value for the patient and therefore should be considered. So the goals in general of integrative medicine, especially as it applies to integrative oncology, is to improve and really maximize the quality of life, to optimize the effects of the conventional treatment, to prevent and manage any side effects that are anticipated. And of course, any therapies that can actually promote the death of those cancer cells are of course important. Managing stress, as you mentioned before, there are lots of things that may not have a lot of evidence behind them, but if they're associated with stress management, then I think all of us can get behind those. Decreasing inflammation is important both in the treatment and in the prevention. We want to regulate blood sugar and insulin sensitivity. This is especially important for prevention and recurrence. And then, as I said, the prevention and of occurrence and recurrence is our major goal. So one of the reasons that my program exists is that patients are already utilizing integrative medicine, but they're not always utilizing it as directed by a healthcare professional. So the medical community, as you can see from the formation of the consortium, has understood that they have a responsibility to actually address integrative medicine in their patients' care. So 62%, there's lots of different surveys, but one of the higher ones shows that 62% of Americans are using some form of complementary or integrative therapy. So that can include everything from yoga to actually using supplements. Only 12% of those, however, are actually consulting with a licensed healthcare provider. So that could be anyone from a medical doctor, a naturopathic doctor, to a nutritionist who spoke earlier. And we know that the numbers are even higher with patients who have been diagnosed with cancer. 80%, some surveys will show over 90% are utilizing some form of lifestyle therapy or actual nutraceutical supplement. And one thing that I'll emphasize is that it's important as I'm bringing up different topics today that anything you hear about that's of interest to you, that you're making sure that you're discussing that with your oncology team. So that's what that's the coordinated care portion of that integrative medicine definition is extremely important. So the backbone of integrative medicine is really lifestyle medicine. So the what we do, we know, has an impact on the expression of our genetics. So even folks with a BRCA mutation who have a very high chance of having breast cancer, we know that even in those instances, their lifestyle, the way they move or don't move, the way they eat, all of that can, and their stress levels, all of that can impact their chance of getting cancer or preventing it from recurring. So we'll start with what I think is one of the most important, especially as in regards to the occurrence and prevention of recurrence of cancer, and that's stress management. So there are so many tools that we have in order to address stress management. One thing I'm realizing I didn't put up on here is therapy. talk therapy with a licensed therapist, psychologist, psychiatrist is definitely an important tool. Meditation is something that I have a conversation about with most of my patients. Luckily, there are a plethora of tools, both in-person classes that have been going on for a long time, but now we have these. You basically, all of us have a meditation guru in our pocket now, with access to free or pretty inexpensive applications. I'll mention, am I allowed to mention a few? We're not doing CEs here. So things like Headspace and Calm, those are very popular. UCLA has a whole research center called the Mindfulness Awareness Research Center, and they have some really great free offerings online, and then they have some very inexpensive courses. So mindfulness-based stress reduction is the most evidence-based form of meditation that was originally studied at the University of Massachusetts. There's different variations on that, including the program that's at UCLA. And I've been trying to bring that into our program, hopefully eventually. Prayer is another important tool for many of my patients. Breathing exercises are often part of meditation, and they're a great tool, I would say, from that meditation toolbox to include throughout the day. It's important. I would say that one of the biggest challenges with utilization of any of these tools is just recognizing that you are stressed. So many of us go throughout our day without checking in about that, without checking in with how we're feeling physically, with how we're feeling emotionally, where we're carrying that tension in our body. So that's one of the biggest challenges. But once you've gotten good at recognizing that and checking in with yourself, then breathing exercises are a great way to take yourself from that fight or flight state into a more rest and digest state. Spending time in nature. So there's some really great studies that have come out of Japan over the last couple decades under the Japanese name, but it translates to forest bathing. So there's studies, basically their Ministry of Forestry and their Ministry of Health collaborated on studies following citizens who were spending time in nature, in these specific sites that they identified as being very, having certain qualities, usually having very dense vegetation, that vegetation giving off a lot of volatile oils, and finding that if patients or if citizens spent 1 to 2 hours per month, that there was a positive effect on immune function and stress management that would last an entire month. And obviously, the more the better. Getting out into nature more than once a month is a fantastic idea too. But that's something I would say for most of my patients, I recommend as a minimum that they're spending that kind of time in nature. And we also have, there's blue zones throughout the world, and a lot of them are located near the ocean. For those of us in California, those of us in Los Angeles, we have access to that. So I definitely encourage patients to make use of the beaches as well. It has a similar effect. Social support we know is important. Pet therapy can be great. Getting support from for those of you who are connected to City of Hope or connected to at Cedars-Sinai, the Samuel Ocean comprehensive center for Institute for Cancer. So they have a fantastic network to support patients through the process. And then one thing that can be, that's probably my favorite part of any visit that I have with a patient is just talking to them about what their purpose is. Talking to them about what the, and this is, you know, sometimes this is the tearful part of the visit, but talking to them about what they're afraid of, but actually trying to turn that fear into understanding what it is that motivates them, what connects them to their purpose, what do they love to do, and recognizing that that's what they need to do more of. So movement is something that's extremely important. There are some studies that show up to a 50% reduction in recurrence from getting adequate exercise. The challenge with this is first determining what your level of fitness is. So the typical recommendation that's pretty evidence-based is that you need to be getting at least 30 minutes per day of some brisk walking or more vigorous activity, but brisk walking is a minimum 5 days a week. That's great for a lot of people if that's what you're able to do, but more is more. It's really about finding the edge of what your physical activity is and then making sure you stay at that edge and that you push that edge. So for a lot of us, you know, brisk walking is not going to be enough, but it's so we're really just maximizing your movement. And I always encourage patients, especially if they're if they perhaps are completing therapy and they're going to start doing more movement again, and they haven't been doing movement for a while, to check in with a personal trainer. Again, those different hospital systems have different types of support that they can offer. Sochi offers a free one. Once you've been treated there, you can go to their gym and meet with their personal trainer for the rest of your life, which is pretty great. And then diet. So luckily, I don't have to spend too much time on this. We've already heard a lot about the power of diet. I included some additional things that I think might be of interest. At the very bottom there, really should be at the top, is that any patients who have low weight or cachexia or having trouble getting enough calories, that's the first question or the first thing that we want to assess is, are you actually being able to eat enough calories in the day before we even look at macronutrients and determine, you know, how much protein, fat, and carbohydrates you're eating. Are you just able to eat enough? And for those who are no longer in treatment or they're looking at prevention, I'm working from the bottom up now, caloric restriction is something that where there's increasing evidence of the benefit of caloric restriction and prevention of occurrence and recurrence. And there's a couple different techniques for that. So there's actual fasting, which is something that you should only do in the, under supervision with a physician. And this is where you're just drinking water. But then fasting mimicking diet. So that's something that was some great research has come out of USC on this, the work of Walter Longo. He has a great book that I recommend reading for anyone who's interested in learning how you can use, you can actually be eating food, but still getting the benefits of fasting, but with a with caloric restriction. And then there's intermittent fasting, which is more and more popular. Most people have heard about that at this point, and that's where you're fasting for 12. I usually recommend 13 as a minimum, 13 hours per day. You know, 6 to 8 of those you're sleeping, so you get those as a pass. So for most patients, that's pretty doable. For some people, they're just doing it a couple days a week. And then I've listed some things that you already heard about that you should be avoiding. These are all pretty obvious. I would say preserved foods are something that I would just really emphasize here. And then of interest would be that garlic and onions have been studied a lot, and that's most of that research comes out of Japan. Japan has the highest rates of stomach cancer, and therefore they've done the most research there on the dietary impacts. But we also know that tomatoes, soy, and high-fiber cereal, interestingly, is something that can help. Again, this is in prevention, and then foods that are high in vitamin A, selenium, and vitamin E. So I would just, you know, work with your nutritionist on identifying what those foods are and finding the ones in your diet that that you like. All right, nutraceuticals. So I think that most people, when they think of integrative medicine, they think of this. And I wish they thought of lifestyle, but they don't. So they think about, you know, what supplements can I take? What supplements can I take in order, maybe instead of doing those lifestyle changes, you know, what supplements can I take and maybe instead of exercising? So it doesn't work like that. So this is, you know, these are intended to be complementary to the rest of those lifestyle changes in order to have that synergistic effect and give you the best outcomes. So one of the things that I focus on with my patients is helping them understand the importance of regulating their blood sugar. This is a challenge for, this is important really across the board, but especially as it pertains to cancer prevention and treatment. So you may or may not know that when your blood sugar rises, you have a spike in insulin. And then if that spike is high enough, you'll have a spike in what's called insulin-like growth factor. And that growth factor, many cancer cells will respond by growing and growing at, you know, more than your other cells. And so a diet that's low in what they call a glycemic index, meaning foods that you eat that if it's a low glycemic index, it won't make your blood sugar spike as much. So these are often foods, you know, obviously fat and protein are going to have a very low glycemic index, but in terms of carbohydrates, the more complex carbohydrates are going to have a lower glycemic index. Those that have fiber in them are going to have a lower glycemic index. And then I'll point out my first nutraceutical here. So a nutraceutical being a dietary supplement or an herbal supplement. So it's given that name because a lot of them at this point are the extracts are what they call pharmaceutical grade extracts, which and they have standardization. So we know exactly how much is in of the active ingredient is in that product. So an extract of green tea called EGCG, it's a polyphenol, which is a certain class of you can kind of think of it as a plant antioxidant. It has a lot of different activities. So I listed some of the different molecular interactions it's going to have with a potential cancer cell. So for those of you who are that level of nerd, that will maybe be of interest to you. One thing to note is that with green tea extract, not green tea itself, but with this this very concentrated form of green tea, that this can deplete vitamin E stores. So I think it's important to mention for anyone who is supplementing this that they are also supplementing vitamin E. And this is reminding me that I'm not going to give you any dosages in here, and that's for a reason. I'm definitely not prescribing any of these to any of you. And I think it's important that for any of you who are considering them, that you'd be working with a qualified healthcare provider. Let's see. And then because of its antioxidant activity, this is one supplement that I think is important to avoid during chemotherapy. There's a couple exceptions, but that's the general rule. Turmeric is also very popular. When I read Aki's notes about this talk, she listed some of the things that she thought it might include. So I made sure that curcumin was one of them, as she had listed that. And that's definitely something that most of my patients are either on already when they come to see me or are interested in taking it and want to know more about it. Some important things to know about it is that curcumin is the important isolate that's within the turmeric. And that is only a small percentage in the actual turmeric, only 3%. So you'd have to have 90 grams of that in order to get a therapeutic dose of curcumin. So I do recommend using extracts and not just having a bunch of curry, as fun as that prescription is. Absorption is a challenge with this. So there are lots of different preparations out there that can enhance absorption. So I've listed some of those there for you. I've also listed the different ways in which it has either anti-cancer activity, the way it can inhibit the formation of blood vessels, It is worth noting that it's a very mild blood thinner. So that's relevant in some patients, especially those of you who are on aspirin or Coumadin. All right. And then specific to stomach cancer, getting lost in the weeds here, but for those who have a STAT3 mutation or expression, then that is associated with a worse prognosis. And curcumin is one of the natural inhibitors of STAT3, so that's worth noting. And then Aki had listed this. I actually don't use this in my practice, but this is a fun opportunity for me to look into this. But fucoidin is an extract from brown kelp. So there's not a ton of research on it yet, but there has been one clinical trial that looked at it during chemotherapy and found an improved response with chemotherapy, but it was a pretty small study size. So I've listed some of the mechanisms of action. And in the interest of time, this one is really important to know that this is much stronger than curcumin. This is an anticoagulant and an antithrombotic, so it breaks down clots, which could be great for some patients, but not for others. So. I've listed some of the more common nutraceuticals that have some sort of evidence to support them. Is you guys taking photos? You're welcome to do that. I'll point out probiotics were discussed briefly earlier, so I put on there one that has some of the best evidence in stomach cancer specifically, so that's the Lactobacillus rhamnosus GG. I'm not going to spend too much time on here, but hopefully you guys, if anyone wants access to these slides, I'll give them to you. So what I've done is just gone through the most common chemotherapy drugs and some of the considerations or some of the research that's around them regarding nutraceutical supplementation and the mitigation of side effects, and then ideally potentiating some of the effects, and then things that you definitely should not be supplementing during while taking them. I'm giving you just enough time so that if you're on YouTube, you can be doing screenshots. Okay. So I think this is a really important slide, things that you should be avoiding in general in chemotherapy. So obviously consulting with your oncologist or meeting with a pharmacist, ideally a pharmacist who has is well-educated in integrative medicine, very hard to find, and oncology, very, very hard to find. We're lucky enough to have integrative pharmacist with 20 years of experience in our practice. She does consultations for patients who she doesn't prescribe anything, but if you're taking something you want to know about safety, you want to look for interactions, then she's a great resource. So you're welcome to reach out and ask me about that. Anything that's going to be interfering with liver detoxification, either speeding up detoxification or slowing down detoxification, is really important to know about. So I've listed some things that can increase detoxification, and we're worried about increasing detoxification of these drugs and lowering the chemotherapy drugs and therefore lowering their efficacy. So real quick, St. John's wort, grapefruit, yohimbe, garlic, rosemary, alcohol and tobacco. In general, the use of antioxidants, especially high-dose antioxidants, is discouraged. In any case, we're going to be deferring to your oncologist, but in most cases, your oncologist is not going to want you to be taking anything that has an antioxidant effect, because the chemotherapy, in part, many of their mechanisms is as a prooxidant, right? So it's a prooxidant and it's causing damage and ideally cell death for the cancer cells. And there are some ones on here that are almost always going to be, we want you to be cautious and avoid. And then it's worth noting that a high sugar diet or high glycemic index diet is something that can also decrease the efficacy of chemo. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention that chemotherapy has been studied for nausea with chemotherapy, with fatigue that's associated with chemotherapy, and it can also be helpful for anxiety and stress management. All right, just a reminder, one of only two images in this whole presentation. Thank you for enduring that. So just a reminder to just be making sure that the integrative medicine is part of a, is truly integrated into your care. And it's part of a comprehensive plan. I wanted to put this slide in here to debunk some very common questions that I get about alkalinizing and about the use of oxygen. So there's absolutely no evidence for that. And I really would discourage patients from, there's lots of evidence contrary to that. So I wanted to discourage my patients from spending too much time and money on that. And then I wanted to offer you a couple resources that I think are helpful. Memorial Sloan Kettering has an awesome website with all the nutraceuticals I talked about. Every one of them is listed on there. There's information for both the patient and the provider. So there's like clinical level discussions and really great references. Especially since I didn't give you any references in here, I would just turn you to this website. If you're someone who's not connected to a hospital system that has resources for you, this is a great online resource that I think everyone should check out, and it's free. And if anyone would like to ask me a question outside of this space, then please feel free to send an email here. Again, I'm happy to share the slides that I showed you today. All right, thanks everybody. I'm sure I'm way over, right?
No, you're fantastic. Okay. Thank you, Stephen. You're good. We'll hold questions for now. Okay. One of the things I wanted to go ahead and stress for everybody here is that it's a lot of information. The good news is that it's all available to rewatch over and over again, so you can take it in. You can use all that information to go back to your doctors and ask them a whole bunch of hard questions.
Yep. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.